Good afternoon to everyone. There are two pre-tributes before the main service starts at 2. The first one is going to be by Karen Crossman, followed by Mr. Nicholas Petty. In that order, please. So you can come now at this podium and give your tributes. Thank you.
Good afternoon, Church. Honorable Sean Richards, family members. As I reflect on the man that I had come to know in my teenage years, I think of a strong and kind man. Strong mouth and physically strong. It was in my high school years, as I was a frequent visitor to the home with or to Shelley, my friend for over some 40 years, I was always warmly welcomed, and I never forgot that. The kindness bestowed upon me from both Joan and Whippy. A little later on, the licks or whipping from Whippy's mouth in the gym would be a constant memory for me. I had become accustomed to Whippy, the cool gentleman in the house, a huge difference to Whippy, my trainer. He pushed and pushed for excellence. He would often say, "Watch them. They see carnival coming, so they run coming in the gym to see what miracle could happen for them. Nothing gonna happen. They need to push harder. Or, but they're coming up here. All of a sudden you see them." Sometimes I wanted to be invisible, so no attention could come from him towards me. It was all for good. I understood that shortly after. As I looked at Whippy, the patient, with his son, Sil, and Shelley by his side, I thought of similar times through my own experience of this kind. He was surrounded by love. I witnessed how they cared for him and nurtured him tirelessly. With love. He fought. I saw that. And he fought. But God had different plans. Sometimes there are no words to comfort. However, may this comfort you always, Shelley. You came and you absolutely did what you had to do. Your best. God will do the rest. Rest in peace, Whippy. Sleep in perfect peace. Okay.
Hide me now under your wings. Cover me within your mighty hands. When the oceans rise and thunders roar, I will soar with you above the storm. Father, you are king over the flood. I will be still and know you are God. Find rest, my soul, in Christ alone. No. When the ocean
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm not trying not to cry, but I love him, so you know what I got. For the last 15 years of his life, me and me just saw the path of his life. Anybody close to him will know that we were his girls. I know he vexed me to death, me say something, because he ain't let me be sad. And I'm going to bring up something sad to talk about. I see you, he said, no, man. Let's don't talk about that. Because the minister me tell we can't laugh, Mel, so they can't laugh and they can't be happy. Are you happy? And he was always a happy person. He wouldn't want us, like, sat up and crying today. And, you know, even though we're going to miss him, he was an awesome man. He was a great man, and he lived a beautiful life. And I had the pleasure of spending beautiful times with him. He would call me every Sunday. Every Sunday he would call me. Sometimes when he can't get me, he would call me and be like, Melso, well, how much time you don't be at, so? I'll be like, call me voice note. When you call me phone, he'll be like, if you ain't get me any bad. So he called me and said, Miss, well, how much time you don't be at, so? I said, a lot. Stop disturbing me. But then, you know, that my husband for life. That me good husband for life. And I'm going to miss you, Whippy. And from my step in here, I just know you're in here. I just know. Your beautiful presence, your laughter. Thank God I used to make video of him, so I got him on my phone, all of him. You're going to rest. After a while, the body get tired, and he get tired, and Lord, he was strong. All in the hospital, he would give me the funny look them used to give me, even when I trouble him, but he, you know, he go and tell him, well, you got a long sleeve, though. He can't talk, you know, but he watching me funny. He wanted to me, but he couldn't. Sometimes this strength just gone. And we come here today to celebrate an awesome man. An awesome, awesome man. And if you're close to him, you know he like you because he don't play with people. He do not play with people, and that's one thing I love about him. He was straight up. If he like you, he like you. If he love you, he embrace you. And VP, I just want to know me and Donna gonna miss you. We love you. We cherish you. Oh my God. I could never forget you. I could never forget your friend. Safe journey until we meet again.
Thank you.
At this time, we'll have the final viewing.
Shall we stand, please? Jesus says, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he died, yet shall he live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. We do not live to ourselves, neither do we die to ourselves. Therefore, if we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For this cause is Christ become both the God of the dead and of the living. Let us continue in this service as we sing the goodness of God. I love you, Lord, for your mercy never fails me. All my life, you have been faithful.
Good. of your life, you should sing of the goodness of God.
Let us pray. Most merciful God, the consolation of the sorrowful and the support of the weary, who does not willingly grieve your children, look down in tender love and pity, we pray, on these your servants whose joy is turned into mourning. According to the multitude of your mercies, uphold, strengthen, and comfort them, that they may not faint under this trial, but find strength and refuge in you. Almighty God, direct us through your word, so that hearing your promises, we may be lifted out of darkness and distress into the light and peace of your presence, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Remain standing, we sing again, What a Friend We Have in Jesus.
What a friend we have in Jesus.
We are gathered in the presence of God to remember and to give thanks for the life of Samuel Whippy Connor, and to affirm God's love for us and to support one another in a time of need. Let us acknowledge our grief and be open in our love, affirming the meaning and mystery of life, confident in the hope of the resurrection through Jesus Christ, our Lord. This time we're going to have the formal remembrance, the eulogy by the Honorable Sean Richards. This will be followed by three tributes as listed in the program. First, Nicholas Petty, the Jeffords sisters, and then Dr. Robert Swingett.
And so the name Whippy stuck with him. He loved his grandmother. She was his heart. In so many respects, he became a whip, whether in words, ambition, or love. The latter part of his education was completed at the Bastia Boys' School. Thereafter, he was employed at the sugar factory and later a cement factory called Cementation. He later gained employment at the airport for the now owner of the famous Uncle T's, Terence Dolphin, who operated a restaurant there called Wings. According to Terence, Whippy was reliable and hardworking. These traits he took to the breweries where he worked for almost 20 years. Whippy was a ladies' man. His journey of parenthood started when Fred, his first child, was born to Irma, who migrated to England. He fathered two more children, Emmy and Larry, with Geraldine. And next three, Sailor, William, and Sean to Aelita. And finally, the last two, Dennis and Shelley, to his wife, Joan, whom he married on January 7, 1974. He accepted Trevor, Joan's first son, as his own. He also raised and adopted Kamika from 12 months and loved her too as his own. Whippy loved and was proud of all of his children. Actually, I heard of many of them even before I met them. He told me of how he met Fred for the first time when Fred was 26. He said this young man showed up at his home. Whippy said he looked at him and in a stern voice asked, "Mister, who you be in my house?" He would boast that Shelley came for music festival or has gone on a cruise, and the stories go on. He would often brag about his grandchildren, especially Dequan and Manny, and enjoyed many phone calls with them. I recall him saying, "Manny called me this morning and asked, 'Grandpa, how you doing?' in his special, loving, and prideful voice." Whippy and Kamika's relationship in particular exemplifies his love for people. Kamika and Shelley developed a bond when she moved to St. Kitts at 11 months. She frequented Shelley's home where she met Whippy and Joan. Whenever she could not be found by her aunt whom she lived with, she was by Whippy's home just a street away in Pine's Pasture. Shortly after her first birthday, Kamika took up residence with Whippy and Joan. When she was 6 years old, a storm came and she stayed with her aunt. When she returned some 4 days later, Whippy discovered that her hand was swollen from being beaten. Immediately, Whippy instructed Joan that Kamika was not to visit her aunt again, or any other family member for that matter. On the day that Kamika, 2 years later, Kamika's aunt tried to take her to the BVI to live with her. On the day that Kamika was supposed to leave with the aunt, Whippy sternly warned Joan to make sure that when he got home from work, that Kamika was there. How Joan managed to do so? She did it. It is said that Whippy whipped the aunt in shape with his saucy mouth and choice words before she left St. Kitts, of course, without Kamika. Kamika credits Whippy for his nurture and teachings. From him, she learned how to care for rabbits, water crops, make conkey, and rum cakes like no other, and the art of honest work. In the words of Kamika, "When my grades slipped in high school, I recalled on the day of the closure of the sugar factory, at the sound of the horn, Whippy reminded me that it will be the last time that the horn will blow. And if I walked up Newtownbury Road, I will see that there are no boats there to pull up. I was urged to graduate from high school. Whippy was my biggest cheerleader, protector, and best father." These are some qualities that his children can attest to. The name Whippy became synonymous with Pond's Gym. He had a passion for health and wellness. Before he opened the gym, he lifted weights with his friends by his grandmother's residence in Cardin Avenue, daily into the evening. After he got married and moved to Malone Avenue, that routine ended. But when he took up residence in Pond's Pasture on William Street, just opposite the police training complex, he opened the Pond's Gym, where Shelley, in a Facebook post, noted that muscles were made there. Whippy's bodybuilding role model was Arnold Schwarzenegger, and he worked hard to get his muscles to look like Arnold's. Joan recalls how Whippy incrementally built his outdoor gym when they moved to Pond's Pasture. Whippy's gym had just about any piece of equipment you were able to find in a modern gym, as he had it fabricated, whether you saw it in a fitness or bodybuilding magazine or elsewhere. As the gym membership grew and the number of machines increased, Whippy got rid of the rabbits and garden to expand. He did not use a cement truck or machine to pave the yard, but did so with the help of Joan and friends. He boasted and was proud of his many clients over the years, such as the late Dr. Richardson, David Lake, Carl Samuel, Carl Louise Leibard, Dr. Dwayne Archibald, Lawyer Jason Hamilton Sr., Platts, Jermaine, Devon, Melissa and Donna, Taya, Erica, and so many others who he developed long-lasting relationships with. Contestants, models, athletes, Ross University students, and persons from all walks of life enrolled at his gym, despite him being a serious taskmaster. Carl Samuel can testify how Whippy whipped him in shape for a bodybuilding competition in which he placed third. Whippy would tell you, if you tell anyone you attend Pond's gyms, you ain't going to embarrass me because nothing about you look like you have been working out. You must look good. We too had our exchanges. Tom would tell you that he would tell me to do 3 sets of 15 of a particular exercise. I would start and do my own count in my head. When I reached 12, I would hear him say aloud, 8, 9, and I would bellow out, Whippy, stop cheating me. You can't count, that's 12. With a sharp tongue, he would reply, Boy Sean, you might be the accountant, but in here, I am the counter. And when I said, this is now the second set, he would say, just watch me. This is the first set, because I don't know what you were doing in the first set. They may count. When people who he deemed overweight signed up for the gym, he would laugh and whisper to Tom, I wonder if they think me is Pastor Shambach to work miracles. When you complained about his exercise regimen, he would let you know that he had already seen the promised land in terms of muscles. And I would quickly tell him that I ain't come here because I'm training for the Olympics, but to keep fit. We would laugh. Whippy was a comedian. He liked to make jokes and speak his mind. Some took to his humor, while others cite as conceit. Barring everything, persons shared the following on the Shelley's Facebook post. Kenrick Brown, my first trainer, the man that taught me what I know about fitness. Julie Charles, my first trainer. Chena Nisbet, the original, all the others are carbon copies. Gerard Amugan, I will always remember walking into his gym the day and him always being the encouraging and motivating person he was. Those memories of him will forever be seared into my brain. Harry Green, he was a pioneer in Gym Yard in St. Kitts. Jason Amri, my first trainer when I started to model from long, long time. And Bernardo Phipps, in East Bastille, there stands in the hearts of those who graced the walls of Whippy's gym, once filled with the echoes of his motivating words and contagious energy, a solemn silence. Shelley Connor, may you and your entire family be strong and find comfort in the many shared stories of your dad's unwavering dedication and abilities to empower people. With sweat drowned in tears, may his patrons find the strength to carry his memories and strive for their fitness goals in his honor. In my view, Whippy was not only an entrepreneur for building and managing the gym, but also an engineer for him and his two brothers who he helped to start gyms. Perhaps he should be recognized nationally for his contribution to physical health and fitness. While living at Pond's Pasture, Whippy started constructing his home. He told the story of being turned down by the first bank, something that did not deter him. After all, the second bank found favor with his application. Unsurprisingly, if you knew Whippy, he went back to the first bank and ordered them to give him all of his money. He built a new family home in Taylor's, and Devon became his construction manager. He journeyed to Taylor's before and after work to check on the progress. When the house was completed, Joan did not want a gym there, and so he granted her wishes. Eventually, Joan and the children moved into the new home without Whippy. Whippy loved his family no less, but had difficulties severing his ties with one of his greatest accomplishments. The gym had become a part of him. It was his livelihood. It was a place where he made lifelong friendships while providing for his family. Whippy had to undergo hip replacement surgery in Puerto Rico some years ago. Some believe that he was born with a hip deformity, but there's another school of thought. While living with his grandmother, he earned income by delivering bread to 4th Street for Larry Kane's grandfather, who had a bakery where CNC is located next to the public market. One morning, the bread was not ready, and Whippy and a friend went into the circus to roller skate. This time, Whippy was not doing the whipping. Instead, the ground whipped him. In colloquial terms, he got a hard fall on his belly. He got back home, was not feeling well, said little to his grandmother, except that he was not feeling well and asked not to go to school. Later, he was rushed to a doctor in Fort Lands and then to the hospital and was looking quite lifeless. A few days later, a friend who witnessed this fall revealed to the grandmother that he had gotten a fall. It is felt that it affected his hip and ultimately led to his surgery, something that affected his mobility, but definitely not his personality. When it began raining during gym time, he would gather his walking stick and let you know that he was going inside because the rain wasn't going to melt this ice cream. Whippy made many friends apart from the gym members. The close vicinity of his home to the police training school and courthouse created paths for him to meet persons such as Hester Rollins. Whippy welcomed the young police recruit who was undergoing training into his house and shared many experiences. They became family. When Hester returned to the police training school as a trainer years later, Whippy provided Hester with whatever he or the other dignitaries needed for passing out parades, a testament to his humanitarianism. Hester, in turn, gave Whippy and Joan a place to rest during his stay in Puerto Rico for his hip surgery. Jose Lloyd, who then worked at the courthouse, recalls that when he began working, he needed someone to prepare at least one solid meal for him per day. He asked Joan, who later discussed it with Whippy. They agreed. From then, Jose and Whippy had a long-lasting bond. Jose would take Whippy for drives, and they attended events such as open-air church services while sitting in the vehicle. On Saturdays, he got his bullfoot soup from Sharon, a next long-lasting friend whom he met when she started working at the courthouse. Interestingly, Whippy's grandmother was the mother of the late pastor, Dr. William Connor. And so, he founded himself in church and Sunday school weekly, whether at Anglican or Antioch Baptist. As an adult, church could not see Whippy. Shelley and others pressed him to go to church, that when he dies, a church would accept him. With a smart mouth, Whippy said that he told them, "Going to church does not mean you will be buried in one." He said there was a man named Mr. Penny. He was a church deacon and attended church every single Sunday. One Easter Monday, Mr. Penny entered a fishing boat race. A squall came and the boat capsized. His body was never found and he was buried at sea, not in a church. It is a true story. He told his sister Theresa, when he died, to wrap him up like a mummy and take him up the burial ground. Truthfully though, Whippy respected God. He tuned in every Sunday to listen to Pastor Lincoln Connor and always questioned what they would do without him. Whippy loved fishing also, but not on a boat. He said on a boat, he could not leave until the captain was ready. Therefore, he took to line fishing. Dennis remembers going fishing with him, starting in Limekiln and ending up in Frigate Bay after many hours, and the expedition only came to an end when Captain Whippy said he was ready to go home. One night, Whippy saw what must have been a very, very big turtle. Terrified, he ran from the water port to home, out of breath, straight to his bed. Another night, Joan heard a banging sound coming from the fridge that forced her out of bed. When she opened the fridge, she found a hedgehog in it partially alive. With anger, she threw it straight over the wall into a drain behind the house, tossing away what may have been tomorrow's dinner. Some days, the catch was plentiful, and so Whippy sold to persons who worked at the then Simaco. He shared his love for fishing with Devon, his grandchild's dad, and provided him with many fishing gears, including his first tackle box. November 22nd, I went to the gym and shouted, "Mr. Connor!" But the usual "Oi!" a coming was not returned. The second day, the same happened. Something felt odd, because Whippy would go to the gym every morning and waited there until his patrons arrived in the afternoon. I completed my workout and went to his home in the village. There he told me that he was sick, but doing much better. Just about every day thereafter, I visited him as he did not return to the gym. In December 2022, I traveled and was concerned about his daily care. As fate would have it, the same day that I left, Irma and his son Fred returned to St. Kitts, and so he was in good hands. On February 12, 2023, he celebrated his 80th birthday with friends and family. He was in very good spirits. In March 2023, Irma and Fred left the island. Family and friends continued visiting him, and in July, it was realized that he was not looking well. Dr. Archibald later checked on him. A few days later, his grandson Ziggy found him unresponsive. He was rushed to the hospital and was revived. Jessica Jeffers was instrumental in his care during the latter months, along with Sil and Ziggy were there with him. Though he was ill, his mouth was still very strong. He kept telling Jessica to get him a bottle of water from the fridge. In turn, she kept telling him that he was hospitalized and there was no water in the fridge. He told her to quit her nonsense, because Pastor Lincoln Connor had just bought him a case of water and reminded her that he is the one who pays the bills in this house. Whippy was admitted and placed on the medical ward. Although the French weed bounced back, other times he would barely respond. Despite the obvious pain that he was in, when you ask him how he was, he always replied positively. On Saturday, 29 July 2023, in the early hours of the morning, he transitioned. Whippy, Coach, Samuel, Mr. Connor, Daddy, or whatever you called him, had many good qualities that we can all emulate. May his family, friends, gym members, and everyone find peace. And may Whippy fly way up above the skies and in between the stars to meet his maker. Thank you.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever wilt be. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great
Good afternoon, church. I'm Jessica. I was one of the fat girls who joined the gym. So when Sean spoke, he meant me. Because the first day I went to the gym, he was like, Miss, where are you going? I can't get a belly move from in front of you, you know, so please go back to the gate. But I really loved his spirit and his personality. I got even closer to him when Toya asked me to just step over where I work at Dr. William Connor. So, you know, I would go over every lunchtime to make sure that he ate and fed him until Sean put a stop into the feeding, because I used to practically feed him with a spoon or a fork, depends on what he was eating. And Sean came one day and he said, Jessica, what are you doing? I said, oh, me wondering, I feed him. Whippy, he can't feed himself. What nonsense you're talking? Whippy, what nonsense you got, Jessica, what are you doing? And from that day, I allowed him to eat by himself. But and he was upset. He was very upset with Sean. But Whippy taught me a lot of things, and I really would miss him. I would really, really, really miss him. Sometimes when I'm really stressed out, I really enjoyed going over there just to sit and chat with him and watch him eat. And those days are no more, but I'm good. And this song that my sister and I will do, it's called God Will Take Care of You, and take comfort in the words of the song. Be not dismayed, whatever betide, God will take care of you. Beneath his wings of love abide, God will take care. Every day
pleasant good day again to all the dignitaries, friends, family members, best wishes. I might be the last piece to the puzzle today, not mentioned, probably barely spoken of. But we complete the puzzle today. Sir Samuel Connor, my favorite uncle. So many years ago, many, many years ago, I migrated. First to St. Martin for a couple years, and then to Canada as a teenager. And I don't think today I would be in the position that I'm in life, managing life and having the respect for life without my uncle, Whippy, as he's called. My name is Robert Springett. People call me Dr. Springett. I was born Robert Connor, the missing piece to the puzzle. So many people are running to me and says, I know you. You are Connor. The lady at the airport says, you sound just like Lincoln Connor. I said, no, but we are families. Long story. I'm trying to make it really short because I am not a funeral person. Have never been to one back here, but I had to get on a plane for this. Every year I come to St. Kitts, what mission is it? Whatever business it is, the people that take care of all my businesses here, get me from place to place. They said, when are you going to Whippy? That's all they asked first. Because I've never come here and not go see him. I never see anyone else. I don't go look for nobody else. They know I'm not going to leave this place, even though I'm here for 2 days or 3 days, unless I go see Whippy. And we start chasing him from up on pasture to the village. Somebody said, he left, he go back again. We got to find him. This is why you always have to have us up and down. So the last trip I had with someone, I think Mr. Sinclair said, I really don't know where Whippy is. The person said, he's in the village. I keep telling you this. And I said, I don't know the places. I don't remember. And we're driving street after street. And he said, but you can't go here, Doc. This is a one-way street. The lady said, if it's Whippy for the gym, he's over at the top. Go up to the William Connor School and turn in. We got there finally. And I looked at him and I said, what's happening? He says, who's that? I said, it's your favorite nephew. He said, Robbie, open the gate. So I said, oh, he remember. I opened the gate, went and sat with him. This was in May 21st. Sat with him. We had a good talk. He asked me, how's the team? I said, they didn't come this time. I came by myself, but I want to see you. Didn't know it would be the last time that I would have been seeing him. I said, how are you doing? You're looking a little small. He said, you know, things happen. You know, you're getting older, you know. And so, okay. And somebody said it so right. I think the honorable minister said he was sharp on the whip with that mouth. Very sharp. As a little boy, I didn't know much. Didn't had much. Didn't dream much. Didn't know what much meant. You did with what you had. You make do with what you got. And you learn to go by. And one day, I was just having my morning routine shower, taking some water to throw over my top of my head with a cup to get to school. I was just, think I was in maybe the third form, 3G5 or something, 3G6 or something at that time. And he looked over the house you see in the picture. That's my house. I live next to him. And he looked over while I'm taking this shower and I'm hiding a little bit, and he says, Robbie! I said, yes, uncle. He says, I want to talk to you. I go closer to the fence. The picture you were seeing with the fence and the gym and that house, that's where I lived. And that's where my uncle lived there. My grandmother lived there. Interesting life. And he says, I see your grandmother is not here. From today, you come over here and you take a shower. Remember, I'm bathing with a cup. He says, from today, you come over here and you take a shower. And Joan will help you by giving you your breakfast every morning. And your lunch will be prepared for you when you come from school. And in the night, you'll pick up your dinner. And you can eat it outside, or I mean over at your place. Or if you come in time, you could eat here, but you eat it over there. And he said, if you have any homework and you need to come in and do, you let me know so you can come in and do it. I was studying under the lamppost. I will go down the end of the street where the bath is and sit there and study. While my friends, all in 3G1 and 3G2 and 3G3, is bragging how bright they are, how intelligent they are, and I don't even have a light in my house to study. And he says, you're going to study your work. Let me know what time you need to come over and study your work. And so I'm not going to be like an emotional wreck or something up here. I walk with my dark shades in case it got out of order, but it's not going to get out of order. I recognized something once sitting down in my room years and years ago. I think it was until I got to my area of life where I attained a PhD and I said, this is not possible without somebody helping you. This is not possible from where you're coming from. From the Macknight to Pasha, from the village, as a matter of fact, to Macknight to Pasha. His same grandmother that he lived with is the same grandmother I lived with, who was my great-grandmother. It's so funny how he became my favorite uncle. And you know, it's a lot of them. He always stayed in my heart. Today, I believe that Whippy made a humongous difference in my life. I have a mother alive, I have a father alive. And I always look over it and said, if he never made that turning point in my life, at that pinnacle, at that spot where everything could have derailed in my life, and I don't have any direction to turn to, I don't know what I've been today. In life, every man has to consist of three major parts. And one is a destiny trustee. Two is a destiny helper. And three is a destiny navigator. My Uncle Whippy was my destiny helper. He helped me in the role of understanding. From a struggling, low self-esteem, young teenager, looking for consciousness and stability and awareness of life to put meaning to. He gave me an inheritance that would live on to my children. If you had Whippy as a father, you have to be something. I don't think you heard it. Because the way in which he speaks to you, the impact that it made, when he's finished, you have to settle yourself down and think about what he really said. And one of the things he gave me in my inheritance that I carry always is the preparation for the future. My uncle established me through an area where I never understood that he was helping me. I just thought he was my uncle because you didn't know anything at that time. As a young boy, he spoke to me with a stern voice. He says, Robbie, get your credentials. Get them today. Because later in life, they will follow you. Credentials. I understood later, he simplified a quote. Very nice way of putting it to a young boy who would easily understand what you're trying to say. Opportunity is taken when preparation meets timing, is what he was telling me. If you're not prepared, it's always going to be a passerby when it comes to opportunity. You're trying to get prepared when it's time to be prepared. I understood it later in life. and use it many times. The second thing he gave me as inheritance was an encouragement of life. Someone has to encourage you to life. There are some hurdles that you alone cannot go over these hurdles. And he stood in the gap when I most needed him, and he encouraged me. My uncle woke me up one day, and he says, "Robbie, stop sleeping so much. You got to do something early. You hear me out here in the gym already?" And I said, "Yes, uncle." He then spoke to me in a nice way, and he says, "When you have some days off school, let me know when you don't have homework. And guess what's going to happen? We are going fishing." Hello, somebody. Round the rocks. I'm round the rocks fishing, and he's got his big net, his big line. He threw the net first, get some stuff. We put it in. I became a master fisherman because of this guy. I love going to fish. It just relaxes you, puts you in the right place. You talk about the turtle earlier. Well, the turtle came out to sea. And both of us are there. And one of our next family, his name is Terry. And Terry's with us. And Terry, myself, and Whippy at the end of the night. And it's pitch dark over the frigate beside. And the turtle comes out. He says, Robbie, be quiet, be quiet. We got to do this. I said, what are we going to do? He said, I'm going to get some help and come back because you guys can't help me. He went to get a guy who works at the factory pier, comes back, and he looks at the turtle. He looks at the guy says, Whippy, you stay here. I'm going to do it. Whippy said, no, let two of us do this thing. He said, no. The guy flips the turtle. It comes back over. Shh, dust everywhere. The sand is in our faces. Whippy said to him, why do you do that? He said, I thought I could do it. Whippy said, I told you could not do it. And the guy left. Whippy looked at me and he said, you see, greed, it will kill us. Then he explained to me, don't be greedy about anything in life, Rob. You would end up with nothing. So in other words, Whippy said the guy tried to turn the turtle by himself. This way he can lay claim to what was going to come out of the meat. You need to understand that later. I learned not to be greedy over anything. Learn to share. Learn to know when to allow somebody to help you. He encouraged me with an area of my life that I was very delicate. Facing people, standing before an audience. You know what I do? I speak for a living. And he says to me, what are you doing? I said, I'm going into school for competition for Calypso. He says, Calypso? He said, let me hear the song. I sang the song to him. He said, oh, I think you got something. And with that, I said, what are we going to do? He says, I'm going to make the signs and the prop and everything for you for the stage. Remember, I'm the missing piece to the puzzle. And he took his time. After the gym is finished, and he made all the prop and everything for me for the stage. I go to school, I sing my calypso, put Ricky Basso on the stage, make him go up with the props, you know, and by the end of the day, I came first runner-up. Whippy said, good, let's celebrate. We won something. I had nobody encouraging me in anything at all. And this man just looked at me and says, it's your time. And he started putting the right faces and the right pieces around my life. And today, every time I turn around, I don't call him on the phone all day and night, but as soon as I know I'm heading to this part of the world, I already have what I have for him, and I already have my time allotted to be with him. And anybody who tell you they traveled me and pick you, my team would tell you he's not going back until he sees uncle. And eventually I had to tell him the story. I literally had to tell him why he's so precious to me, why he's so important to me. Because no one on this planet took that little gap and that little time when it was most needed in my life to put me on the right path of life. But him making that call, seeing me showering with a cup and say, come over and bathe here. Eat here. Eat your lunch. Have your dinner. I'm in class with people who are doing well. I think they think they were doing well. They're living great. They don't know I'm showering with a cup. And he thought that he could make a change and make a difference, and he did. And I always tell him, we had a really good talk in May. Just two of us were there the Saturday afternoon, and we sat there for a good while. And my driver sat and waited. He says, man, like you're going to live there. I said, man, I wanted to catch up with him for a good while. Like every time I come, I'm in and out too fast. And he says, yeah. I said, he's make a difference in my life, my friend. You don't know. One of these days you'll know. He still don't know because he's not here today. He wanted to be here. He told me he went to another funeral. So I didn't know there was another funeral. I made the junior finals that year. And he says, Robbie, next year you're going to get them. Oh, he was ready again to encourage me again. I thought, oh, you made the finals, you know, forget it. Like, you're not going to make it ever again. He says, next year you'll get them. He was always my encourager. I don't know about many of you who met him, but he was a life changer. He was a difference. And he was put here definitely as a purpose. My last piece that I recognized that he did, and he did it out of pure heart. And I asked him, I said, Whippy, let's talk now. So how is the God thing? Like, this is us talking here today. How is the God thing? He said, boy, Robbie boy, you know me already. And he said, listen, Lincoln every Sunday. I said, listen, Lincoln every Sunday. How is the God thing? He said, well, you know, the God is control everything. We know this. And he started telling me some little things about what he thought. And I just left it as that. And I said, my hope is we will meet again. He showed a care of love to me as a teenager. Basically took me and gave me a chance at life. He gave me a chance to make adjustments, to make advancements, and to achieve. I simplify a quote looking at him one day of what he did for me. And I recognize it is so important when we can build something that lasts around someone who has done something for us. Not just a monument of stones, but something that stays in our heart. And I produced this quote out of my heart. I said, care is not what you do for people who can give back to you, but rather what you do for people, for those who can't give back to you. Thank you, Uncle Whippy. Thank you for being there at the right time in my life. I've never been with a cup again from since that time. Could you imagine just saying, come over, do your homework. My wife will cook lunch. You will get your dinner. I've never cooked again on 3 stones. That's where I cooked while going to school. I never took soap again and put under my armpits so I could smell okay. And you think that I shouldn't come for 2 days. For his funeral. You think that every time I landed here and my foot touched the ground in St. Kitts, I shouldn't go and see him. You should think again. Robert Springett, born Robert Connor. Bless you, Uncle Whippy.
Thank you for those remembrances. A portion of Holy Scripture will be read from the Psalm 98 division, verses 1 through to 12. Psalm 90, verses 1 to 12.
Good afternoon. Here beginneth the scripture reading. Lord, thou hast been our dwelling place in all generations. Before the mountains were brought forth, or ever thou hast formed the earth and the world, even from everlasting to everlasting, thou art God. Thou turnest man to destruction and saith, return, ye children of men. For 1,000 years in thy sight are but as yesterday when it is past, and as a watch in the night. Thou carriest them away as with a flood. They are as asleep in the morning. They are like grass which groweth up. In the morning it flourisheth and groweth up. In the evening it is cut down and withereth. For we are consumed by thy anger, and by thy wrath are we troubled. Thou hast set our iniquities before thee, our secret sins in the light of thy countenance. For all our days are passed away in thy wrath. We spend our years as a tale that is told. the days of all years are 70 years and 10. And if by reason of strength there be 80 years, yet it is their strength, labor, and sorrow, for it is soon cut off, and we fly away. Who knoweth the power of thine anger? Even according to thy fear, so is thy wrath. So teach us to number our days, that we may apply our hearts unto wisdom. This is the end of the scripture.
Thank you very much. Let me acknowledge the presence of our Deputy Prime Minister, the Honorable Dr. Jeffrey Handley, and others who have come today to share with the family in this our time of bereavement. Lots have been said of Whippy already, and each of you have your own memories, and so I will not speak to personal experiences except to say that he was very generous, and I was very grateful for always supporting my grandmother who raised me so that I myself could be a blessing to so many today. The ushers would wait on us as we sing, and at this time we ask you to give. I think sometimes in funerals we say we ain't giving no money, we ain't supposed to collect money in funerals and all kind of stuff, and people think church have a lot of money, and I ain't come here to talk about money, but sometimes you look at the offering in a funeral and it's next to nothing. And all this lot of AC and comfort that you like, it costs money. It really costs money. So the alternative is to open the doors, open the window, and have your fan in all day. And that's just the reality of the situation. I make no apologies for those things. You go to the bathroom, you use tissue. Last month I went, I bought a pail of tissue. They tell me $145. I go back a month later, they told me $181. And next month when I go, I expect it to be over $200. This is serious business. When you go into institutions and stuff, things cost money. This is serious, serious business. And so we expect you not to think that church want money and what am I money for funeral for. We are providing you a service, and you should pay for it. So let's get a good offering in that offering basket. At this time, I didn't intend to say this, but you have to speak up. Insurance rates have gone up. All of you, your property insurance has gone up for the next year. If you know what I'm talking about, ours have gone up. It's $1,000 extra every single month. That's $12,000 extra for the year. What do? You still have to meet the needs of people, help people who are in need and all of that, and people giving less. It's a balance. And people who go to church know that the church does a great deal in our community. And so we have to begin to understand and appreciate. Just as you have bills in your home, the church have bills too. Amen. So help us as we are sing at this time, please.
Amen. We'll do. The Lord's my shepherd. If we are to give, then the Lord is going to provide, right? The Lord's my shepherd, I'll not want. He makes me down to lie. In pastures green, he leadeth me. The quiet waters by singing
my head dollars with oil and my him. Heaven and earth adore him. What a mighty God we serve. Sing, what a mighty God, what a mighty God.
Thank you for these gifts and those who are able to give. We pray you would bless us. Your word says it's more blessed to give than to receive. May now, in the hearing of your word, would be better for hearing, in Jesus' name. Amen. As it is expected, I will share with you a thought from God's word. The Bible is interesting. There are many things, and even within the course of our lifetime, we'll not be able to unravel all of the interesting intricacies and details of the Word of God. But there are several contrasts in Scripture that I believe many of us are familiar with. It starts out with Cain and Abel. They were two sons of Adam. One chose a good path, while the other chose an evil path. Abraham and Lot, they were two relatives. One selflessly gave up everything for God, and the other one followed selfishly his own way. Jacob and Esau, these were twin brothers. One was a rugged outdoor man, and the other tended to stay around the home and help his mother. David and Saul, 1st and 2nd Kings of Israel. One chose to seek God, the other chose not to seek God. Peter and Judas Iscariot, these were two of Jesus' disciples. One betrayed him, and the other sought forgiveness in the face of judgment. In Luke chapter number 23, we have two contrasts. The Bible tells us that Jesus was crucified between two thieves. And one cried mercy, and the other died in his sin. Now people look at this passage and think, well, this is a deathbed confession. It is. And oftentimes in our life, in trying to understand God, and I would dare say that there are lots of things none of us really have the answer to. It doesn't matter how long you've been converted. It doesn't matter how much Bible school you went, how much apostle, prophet, prophetess, pastor, teacher you sit under. There are some things, Ricky, we do not have the answers to. So let us take a quick look at these two men in Luke chapter number 23 today. One of these men, we said, he would cry for mercy and the other would die in his sin. Now the Bible tells us of these two men that they were notorious criminals. They were found guilty by Rome and they deserved death for their crimes. But when we look at these two men, we are reminded of one thing, that all of us are in the same predicament. You say, but preacher, how do you mean we are in the same predicament? Romans chapter number 3 and verses 10 to 12 says, there is none righteous. No, not one. This is St. Paul. And he says, no one who understands. There is no one who seeks God. All have turned away. All like have become worthless. There is not one who does what is good, not even one. Those are the words of St. Paul. Paul says that we are in the same predicament. We have Jesus Christ who is standing, and we are on the right and on the left, and we are no good. And he further says to us in Romans chapter 6, verse number 23, because we are all lawbreakers and we are no good, he says the sentence of death has come down upon every single one of us, that the wages of sin is what? But the gift of God is eternal life. Now that is bad news. No matter how good you think you are, no matter how pristine your life you think it is, no matter your accomplishments, that is bad news, that the wages of sin is death. But there is some good news. In Luke chapter number 23, the word of God reminds us that in this moment of that good news, we find that these two men are with Jesus, and one starts mocking him, not appreciating the condition that he is in. He begins to mock him, and he says, you save a lot of people. Save yourself. Come down. Demonstrate to us that you are God. Well, I believe that in some way, that both of them were mocking Jesus. You know, in our life, we just start out mocking, and then we change as time goes on. I believe both of them started out mocking Jesus. But you see, somewhere during that time, in the final hours, one began to realize that this thing was real. You see, all of us are going to live our life the way that we say we want to live it. We hear people say all the time, I'm going to live my life. It's my life. I'm going to do whatever, finish it, I want. And as you go on living your life, if you are in tune to the movement of the Holy Spirit in the world. Our passage read to us today says, the days of our years are 70 years and 10. And if by reason of strength there are more, yet we are all going to end it with a sigh. If you are wise, you would realize that as you progress in life, that time is running out. Something must tell you time is running out. The things you used to do, you can't do them no more. The steps you used to run up, you can't even walk up one without gasping for breath. The hair you had on your head have all disappeared. And if you still have them, they turn white as snow. And I don't care how much dye you put in them, they're still gray. Because you know that they're gray. So remind yourself they're gray. For every time you remind yourself they're gray, it reminds you that time is running out. Because we think that we could turn back the hand of time. We could exercise. That's good. Nothing wrong with that. We be at a gym and I see when I go up there all there lifting the weight and everything, that's good. But no matter how much weight Sean lifts, his belly is still big. Now those of you who find it offensive, I didn't pick on you because I know you'll find it offensive. I choose my people because I know who my friends be. The reality is you start to realize that time is going. When your children start to leave home for college, time is going. And this man, he recognized that as time drug on and the deal on the cross, that this thing is for real. And the first man who would curse God would choose to use his dying breath in rebellion against God. Brothers and sisters, I want to challenge you that we do not have knowledge of when our time will come. And we must prepare so that in that moment we can use our dying breath to praise the Lord. It was Susanna Wesley, wife of John Wesley, who said, children, when I'm dying, sing me a happy song. You see, but there was another who, when he recognized time was running out, he chose his dying breath to repent. There is sometimes in the Christian church this idea that people who come late don't have any place. Well, I ain't the judge of that. Did you hear me? I'm not the judge of that. What I do know is that Jesus says, whosoever will may come. What I also know, he says, whoever come, I will not cast him away. What I also know, he says, he's not willing that any should perish, but that all should come. So even in your dying breath, because it's demonstrated here in the book of Luke that some people even in their dying breath would not even make that decision. I've had calls to the hospital. They say, Pastor, come help us. This person just won't settle down. They won't get up to go for their money and their bank account. And Pastor, come help us. And I go there. And I feel sad. Because you can't constrain them, restrain them. They're like legion among the tombs. Let me go. I'm going to get up. And I go. And they're on their last breath. I want you to understand this. On his last breath, he says, Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom. wasn't kneeling. He wasn't in a church. He wasn't speaking in tongues. He didn't have an apostle, a prophet. He had the weakness of the Holy Spirit. And no matter where you are, when it is, if there is the weakness of the Holy Spirit, He will tell you what to say. Sometimes I find it difficult because in our culture, we think that you got to call the pastor. When the Holy Spirit talks to you, you don't need to call no pastor. You say what He tells you to say. And you don't need a lot of words. All the teeth on the cross says, Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom. All that the publican say, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. But alas, we have tried to say that if you're going to pray, you have to do this and you have to do that. No, when the Holy Spirit speaks to you, you must respond. For it is a beautiful day when He speaks, for He doesn't always speak. The Bible says there comes a time, quickly, when His Spirit does not always strive with man. In other words, you will not hear, you will not feel any nudging to say anything to God. You will have no desire to pray. When you start to have no desire to pray, when you start to have no feeling for church, the Bible and the things of God, you are in a terrible place. You need to find yourself at the foot of the cross. Because that is an indication that God's Spirit is leaving you. For every time you hear the word of God, no matter who the preacher is, because St. Paul said to the church at Philippi that there were those who are preaching out of false pretense and gain. But as long as the word of God is being preached, so let it be. There are preachers who are going to preach to you solid messages for you to know Jesus and going to be in hell. But the Spirit of God will use it for your benefit. And whenever you feel the Spirit of God speaking to you, you respond. You see, let me say to you finally and quickly that this thief on the cross was in his final moment. You may be all active. You may be all happy. You may be all twinkled eye, and you are yet in your final moments. And the Spirit has revealed to you to pray. You say, God, I'm going to do that tomorrow. God, I'm going to do that later. We've all had those occasions in our life, but we feel no any time for that. I got time to do this later. You do not know. This may be your hour when you are standing between God, hanging in the balance between life and death, heaven and hell, eternal separation, or a joyful welcome. You don't own your life in your hand. You have your plans. But God has the final say. You think you are too young to die at 25, at 30, at 40, at 50. Why? Because no matter how much we say we love people, we're going to go to Springfield, all of us. All the niceties we talk, all the children here and grandchildren. As much as you think you can't live without him, you're going to bury him and your life going to go right on. Because none of you love him that much to go down in the hole with him. Not one of you. Don't care how much you say you love him. And the point that I'm making is this. You may think that you are too young, but you don't own your time. God owns your time. But look at the promise that he makes. When you think about the thief on the cross, he didn't just say, Lord, remember me. Jesus responded. He says, today you shall be with me in paradise. Let me say this to us, my friends, then. It was Thomas Mabilia of Congo, Africa, who puts it this way. He said, the thief prayed, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Jesus said to the thief, I'll see you soon. You see, the reality is, those who trust Jesus Christ, whenever, wherever, he says, I'll see you soon. Soon, maybe 50 years. Soon, maybe the next few hours. But 1,000 years with the Lord is as one day. And one day as 1,000 years. But there is no better life than a life that is committed to serve the Lord. We've seen it every single time. Every funeral service we go to is a reminder that your clock is ticking down. That your time is coming to an end. One day somebody will eulogize you. But no matter what they say about you, is what the King of Glory will say. Will he say, come ye blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom? Or will he say, depart from me, I never knew you? Because no matter what you say, you say, but Pastor Connor, you really don't know what happens on the other side. No, I don't. But I've trusted God for things in this life, from this world, and I've seen it manifest. So I'm going to trust him for what he says will happen in the end. And I'm better off trusting than not trusting. Because you see, even if I were to drop dead and there is no heaven and hell, it is worth living a life that is committed to Christ in this life. Because you avoid lots of heartache and pain when you are serving God. So today, Whippy is no more. All the good memories will live on, but he's no more. We must make an account of our life. And I pray that God's Holy Spirit would speak to us so that we would take stock and we would hear God say, when we make that profession of faith, I'll see you soon. My God, I'll see you soon. I'll see you soon. I'll see you soon. Let us pray. Father, thank you for loving us when we could not love ourselves. Thank you for life. And yet, thank you for death. For your word clearly tells us to everything there is a season and a time to every purpose under the heavens. May we live our life in the knowledge that we have to give an account to you. And if we hear the Spirit speaking today, may we be obedient. Shall we stand, please? Let us pray. Now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead O Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, make you complete in everything good, so that you may do his will, working among us that which is well-pleasing in his sight. Through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend Samuel Winston Connor. Acknowledge, we pray, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into your arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints of light. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We'll sing a recessional song soon, and very soon we are going to see the King. Come. I am the resurrection and the life, says the Lord. Those who believe in me, even though they die, yet will they live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Sure and certain hope to a resurrection, we commend to the ground the body of Samuel Winston Connor, earth to earth, dust to dust, ashes to ashes, and leave his soul with God or Maker. And I heard a voice from heaven saying, "Blessed are the dead who die in the Lord," says the Spirit. "They rest from their labors, and their works do follow them." Let us pray. Almighty God, in the beginning, you formed us from the dust of the earth and breathed into us the breath of life. So also in the last days, you have promised to raise us up from the dust so we might assume a new body at the coming of your Son. For as in Adam all died, so in Christ shall all be made alive. We thank you for this hope for all those who have died in you, that they will be raised to life imperishable. Look down upon us with tender pity and compassion, and grant each of us the comfort of your Spirit. Renew within us the joy of your salvation. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, world without end. Amen. Now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, make you complete in everything good, so that you may do his will, working among us that which is well-pleasing in his sight, to Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. And the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, the fellowship of the blessed Holy Spirit, rest, remain, and abide with us, both now and forevermore. Amen. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God. Born of his Spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. And this is my story, this is my song.
when I'm praising my Savior all the day long. Oh, perfect submission. Oh, perfect delight. Visions of rapture.
Visions of rapture.
Now burst on my sight. Angels descending.
Angels descending.
Wind from above.
Wind from above.
Echoes of mercy.
Echoes of mercy.
Whispers of love.
Whispers of love.
And this is my story.
This is my song.
Praising my Savior all the day long.
This is my story.
This is my story. This is my song. Praising
my Savior all the day long.
Perfect submission. All is at rest. I in my Savior.
I in my Savior.
I'm happy and blessed, watching and waiting, looking above, filled with His goodness, lost in His love. And this is
my story,
this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch.
Oh,
than when we first begun. Praise God, 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 praise God.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forevermore. Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee.
Thou changest not.
Thou changest not. Thy compassion is filled.
As thou hast been.
As thou hast been. Thou forever wilt be great. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness.
Morning,
morning by morning, new mercies I see.
All I have needed.
Summer and winter and springtime and harvest, sun, moon and stars in their courses above.
Join
with all nature in manifold
witness to thy great faithfulness.
Unto the hills, from whence cometh my help? My help cometh from the Lord, which made heaven and earth. He will not suffer thy foot to be moved. He that keepeth thee will not slumber. Behold, he that keepeth Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is thy keeper. The Lord is thy shade upon thy right hand. The sun shall not smite thee by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord shall preserve thee from all evil. He shall preserve thy soul. The Lord shall preserve thy going out and thy coming in from this time forth and even forevermore. Amen. My anchor holds that the angry surges roll on my tempest-driven soul. Though the angry surges roll on my tempest-driven soul, I am peaceful for I know I live.
Bye.
love that will not let me go. I rest my weary soul in thee. I give thee back the life for you that in thine ocean depth. Oh, love that will not let me go. I rest my weary soul in thee. I give thee back the life I owe, that in thy ocean that it flow may reach up for me. Oh, life that followeth all my way, I yield my flickering touch to thee.
And all If you give a little more than you take, and if you try to fix more than you break, if you're the kind who takes the time to help a stranger in the rain, there's a place out there for people like you. If you stand up for those on the knees and lend a voice to those who cannot speak, if you shine a little light, give sight to the ones who lost the way, there's a place
quietness and trust.
rest and trust. When the ocean rises and thunders roar, I will soar with you above the storm. Father, you are king over the flood. I will be still and know you are God. I will be still and know you are God. When the ocean rises and thunders roar, I will soar with you. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us.
You came from heaven to earth to show.
Loving God, we thank you for the life that we have shared with Whippy. Remember all the good things that were started, which are now part of our history. We thank you for his gifts and skills, the way they were used to benefit his family, community, and country. We know that our lives were blessed by his presence. May we continue to live our lives inspired by memories of him. And may the significant part that he has played in the life of others, which now is silent, make each of us thankful to you. And now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, make you complete in everything good, so that you may do his will, working among us that which is well pleasing in his sight. To Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. The service is here concluded.